Welcome, dear students. This is Dr. Hani Nadeem. In this lecture, we are going to describe the fetal circulation and explain the postnatal changes that occur to it. There are three differences between the fetal circulation and the postnatal circulation. The first difference is that the source of oxygenated blood in the fetal circulation is not the lungs. The main source is the placenta. The lungs are collapsed, and the placenta is the only site where gaseous exchange takes place. The second difference is that there are three types of blood in the fetal circulation: highly oxygenated blood, disoxygenated blood, and mixed blood. Whereas postnatally, there are only two types of blood. The last difference is that there are five structures present in the fetal circulations which become rudimentary in the circulation after birth. These structures are the umbilical vein carrying oxygenated blood from the placenta, the two umbilical arteries carrying unoxygenated blood to the placenta. There is a ductus venosus connecting the umbilical vein with the inferior vena cava, and there is a ductus arteriosus connecting the arch of aorta with the left pulmonary artery. And there is an opening between the two atria, which is the foramen ovale. Well, let's follow the blood in the fetal circulation. Oxygenated blood from the placenta runs through the umbilical vein to reach the left branch of portal vein in the liver. Most of this blood passes through the ductus venosus, which is a shunt between the left branch of portal vein and the inferior vena cava, or it may enter into the sinusoids of the liver. Of course, this is a shortcut, whereas running through the sinusoids of the liver takes a lot of time. There is a sphincter here at the beginning of the ductus venosus, which constricts to divert blood to the sinusoids of the liver in case the pregnant woman is exposed to a blow to the abdomen or any pressure that will make the blood gush into the fetal heart to prevent its overloading. So this sphincter functions to protect the growing heart. From the inferior vena cava, the oxygenated blood becomes mixed with very little unoxygenated blood coming from the abdomen and lower limbs, and then it passes into the right atrium. From the right atrium, it passes through the foramen ovale to reach the left atrium. Why this blood goes from right atrium to left atrium? Due to three factors. The first factor is that the lower border of the septum secundum, which is called the crista dividens, directs it to the foramen ovale. The second factor is that pressure in the right atrium is much higher than the left atrium because the lungs are collapsed and there is no blood or very poor blood coming from the lungs to the left atrium. The third factor is that the opening of inferior vena cava lies directly opposite the foramen ovale, and the stream is fast, so it goes from the inferior vena cava to the left atrium, passing through the right atrium. From the left atrium to the left ventricle to the ascending aorta to the arch of aorta. From the ascending aorta, the two coronary arteries supply highly oxygenated blood to the heart itself. And from the arch of aorta, the three big branches, the brachiocephalic, left common carotid, and left subclavian, supply blood to the head and neck, which contains the growing brain, and the two upper limbs. So the most important structures receive highly oxygenated blood. Of course, this blood is mixed with little unoxygenated coming from the inferior vena cava, and very little unoxygenated blood coming from the lungs to the left atrium, but still it's highly oxygenated. So the important structures receive highly oxygenated blood. From these structures, from the heart, through the coronary sinus, unoxygenated blood passes to the right atrium. From the head and neck and upper limbs, blood collects through the superior vena cava to the right atrium, to the right ventricle. Does this blood mix with that coming, with oxygenated blood coming from the inferior vena cava? Very, very, very little, if any, blood is mixed. How can this happen? Because the two streams are far away from each other. They take different planes in the right atrium, and their speed is different. The speed of this stream is different from the speed of this stream. And the crystal dividence separates both from each other. Therefore, the unoxygenated blood or the poorly oxygenated blood goes from the right atrium to the right ventricle, to the pulmonary trunk, to the pulmonary arteries, but the lungs are collapsed. Very little blood goes to the lung to supply it, but most of this blood passes through the ductus arteriosus to the arch of aorta. In such case, the descending aorta contains mixed blood from the oxygenated blood in the arch and the poorly oxygenated blood from the ductus arteriosus. This mixed blood will go to supply organs of the abdomen and the two lower limbs. In such case, we have to, it's very important to notice that the upper half of the body receives highly oxygenated blood, the lower half of the body receives mixed blood, because the most important organs lie in the upper part of the body. GIT, urinary system, genital system are not necessarily needed at this stage. The lower limbs are poorly developed in the human compared to the upper limbs because the human newborn cannot walk in contrast to animals which are born running and walking. The human takes at least 1 year until he or she becomes able to stand and walk. So development of the nervous system is so important, the heart is so important, the upper limbs for manual dexterity are important. This poorly oxygenated blood or mixed blood passes through the iliac arteries and from the internal iliac artery to the umbilical arteries, which carry mixed blood to the placenta, where reoxygenation takes place. So in summary, highly oxygenated blood from umbilical vein, ductus arteriosus instead of sinusoids, with the sphincter controlling this flow, inferior vena cava to right atrium, foramen ovale, left atrium, left ventricle, ascending aorta, arch of aorta, supplying highly oxygenated blood to the heart, brain, upper limbs. Return of unoxygenated blood through superior vena cava to right atrium, right ventricle, pulmonary trunk, left pulmonary artery, ductus arteriosus, to mix with this oxygenated blood to the descending aorta, to the iliac arteries, to the umbilical arteries, to the placenta for reoxygenation. Okay, now it's time to test our knowledge and see if we understood what has been mentioned. Let's try to cross match between the vessel in column A and the type of blood in column B. I advise you to press the space bar or pause the video, try to answer by yourself, and after a while, come back and I will give you the answers. Okay, now let's see. The umbilical vein. Umbilical vein carries highly oxygenated blood. All right. The superior vena cava. Oh, the superior vena cava brings blood from the head and neck, all right, and upper limb, so it's poorly oxygenated blood. The ascending aorta, highly oxygenated blood. The umbilical artery, mixed blood. Yeah, that's right. And the ductus arteriosus, poorly oxygenated blood. I hope you have answered like this. Okay, now we will come to to the second part of the lecture, which are the postnatal changes that occur to the fetal circulation. What happens after the baby is born? Well, first thing is that pressure in the two atria becomes equal. Why is that? For two reasons. Number one, respiration begins. As the baby takes the first breath during crying, the lungs expand, blood will pass to it and returns to the left atrium, so pressure increases in the left atrium. Okay, the second change is that the umbilical cord is ligated and cut. There is no blood coming to the umbilical vein or from the umbilical arteries to the placenta. Okay, so this blood is reduced, or no blood passes through this pathway. So little blood passes to the right atrium, so pressure in the right atrium becomes reduced. So pressure increases in the left atrium and is reduced in the right atrium, making the pressure equal in the two atria. For that reason, the two septa in between the atria, the septum primum, the septum secundum, touch each other. The foramen ovale is closed, giving the fossa ovalis and the annulus ovalis. This is the first remnant. The second remnant is that the umbilical vein becomes obliterated and later fibrosed to form the ligamentum teres. The umbilical arteries become also fibrosed, forming the medial umbilical ligaments. The ductus venosus becomes fibrosed to form the ligamentum venosum, and the ductus arteriosus becomes also fibrosed to form the ligamentum arteriosum. So now again, let's try to cross match and see if we can understand what we have just said. Also, pause the video, please, by pressing the space bar, and later on come back for the answers. Okay, now the ligamentum venosum comes from the ductus venosus. Same thing for ligamentum arteriosum, ductus arteriosus. All right. Ligamentum teres, this was the umbilical vein. Medial umbilical, median umbilical, oh, we haven't mentioned that. Well, it will be heard in the urinary embryology, but for this time, the medial umbilical ligament comes from the umbilical artery. So by exclusion, the median umbilical ligament comes from the allantois or urethras. Okay, so in summary, we have said that the upper half of the body of the embryo receives highly oxygenated blood in comparison to the lower half of the body. And we mentioned that there are remnants of the fetal circulation, two ligaments and three ligamenta. Thank you. And we will meet again, hopefully, in other lectures. If you find my lectures useful to you, please hit like and subscribe to my channel. Thank you so much.